Each note legatissimo.
You must get to the point. That's it.
Beethoven remains constantly contemporary. This music really deals with the completeness and the innermost nature of the human condition. It is about the necessity to push yourself to the limit. It does not shy away from the extremes. That out of chaos, out of strife, comes a new order.
What I would like is to let go and to forget about myself and to enter the world of the sonata. I would like to enter that world and after stop, finish the piece and go back in the world, the real world. That's what I would like to do.
Thank you. you play with so much character and color and characterization. It's really wonderful. This is the most apparent quality in your playing this. And whatever else you learn about music in your life, you mustn't lose that, because this gift for characterization is very, very rare. Mm-hmm. and very seldom. It's something very, very precious you have. The problem with having such a creative gift is that I think I would attempt to say without meaning to, sometimes you feel you can bend even the text for the benefit of the characterization. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there comes a moment when liberty becomes anarchy. And this is, you have to be a little bit careful. The first thing about that is the steadiness of the tempo. When you have a piece of music that is constantly using silence, breaks in the music, yeah, as an integral part of it, it means it must have a very strict regularity. You know, when you play it's very important that the empty bars, the empty moments, are of exactly the same pulse as the music. Mm-hmm. And the dynamics totally separated one from the other. What is piano is piano, and what is forte, yeah, is forte. So that there is a continuous, so that you get the commentary of that, okay, that you get a different world that is not the same. I would make that a little bit clearer. And the last thing, if I may say, be very careful when you play three shortened chords, like. Uh-huh. Be very careful, because the tendency is to lift the hand for, I don't know for what reason, mm-hmm, not just you, and to, without meaning to, accentuate the last chord. So you hear this. Uh-huh. Which is yum, boom.
Yeah, of course.
Yum, boom, boom. Yum, boom, boom. Uh-huh. And the last one, before the subito forte, I will play a little bit less. Yum, boom, boom. Yum, boom, boom. And okay, really keep really white and black. Okay? Okay, let's start once more. You said you're rushing. No, you're rushing already. Padam, uh-huh, padam, padam. My hand hurts. When you play soft, you lose the sense of the weight of the sound and you get faster. Uh-huh. Do the characterization with the volume and with the phrasing, yes, but not with the tempo. Okay. Also, be a little bit careful. The second syncopation very often comes too soon, and it is.
I was born in 1985 in Nice, in France. My father is a dentist. My mother is my mother, so they're not musicians. I did piano because my older sister was doing piano. There was a piano in the house, so. It was a musical house, I would say. Not musical parents, but musical house. I think that's important, yes. For me, the sonata, it's very hard, of course, because you have to understand so much all the time. You have to analyze so much. You have to know what he means. If you want to express something, you have to forget about yourself. You have to forget about your ego. You have to forget about everything that's around, all your problems, because you're not yourself. You're not the composer either. But you're something else. You are the piece, basically. You try to be the piece. And that's the ideal of the artist, I think, to lose yourself. And that's what I'm looking for.
That's very good. A couple of small things I would like to mention to you about this. You must never underestimate the intelligence of the ear to remember things. Uh-huh. When you play a sequence, you have to assume that the ear remembers exactly and expects the same sequence. And when you break the sequence, it is all, whether it is rhythmical, harmonic or melodic, it is a very important moment which has to be clear. In other words, you play this. No. One sequence, okay? So now. The same, yes? Now you expect. Something new.
Yes, yes.
So you have a sequence once, then you make a strange modulation. You repeat that in F major. Mm-hmm. F major must sound here so far away from G major, you know, it must be really foreign territory. And then you repeat that exactly, the repeat of the sequence, and then you make a commentary, you go on. This must be very clear.
Yes.
Number one. Number two, I would start this. Not so loud. You start too loud, and you reduce your possibility of dynamic range. And then when you do this wonderfully. I must say the articulation is not easy, but the sforzando you must get more. I think you must control your energies so that you have something left for the sforzando. Why don't you play just from here now? We'll go back to the beginning again later. Also, look how this is a big interval.
Yeah.
This is a small interval.
Yes, yes.
I want to hear the difference.
Yes.
Especially when you get the big interval the second time, it must open in the sound. Always dangerous when you go into an accent, when you need more power to fall into it even a little bit too soon. Better a little bit too late, better place it. As if you were doing in language, you would put a consonant on the sforzando, not a vowel, not ah or sh or whatever, ta, whatever. Once more. David, I just want to ask you, why do you play in two bars, no? You play and now suddenly you make...
No, I don't want that.
I think you did the opposite. The more tempestuous you begin it without an accent, the more you will get of that. Better. It's not quite right yet. It's better. I'll tell you, no, because you have, in order to do that, when you're coming down, I'll do it for you in slow motion. In order to avoid this, you have to play to the end. And come down very carefully. Okay. And then, as you don't have still the faith in your own control of the speed to place the accent. And that's why it lacks the strength because you still fall into it. But it's much better. Once more. Yes.
can really, the accent, and come down, and again. Forte, isn't it?
I don't think in my score it's
forte. It's forte. It's forte. No, it's forte. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry, in my score, I'm sure it wasn't.
I believe you. But it is, there's definitely forte. That's really very, I think that's important.
Okay.
The second syncopation is ta-dam, pa-dam, pa-dam. Also, when you play in forte, make sure that you don't accentuate the end of the group. Otherwise, it doesn't allow you to continue.
Yes.
Now.
Yes.
This is interesting. This is important. In order to do that, you must never give it away before. Uh-huh. And make sure you play.
Yes.
That it resounds to the end. Yum. Commentary, yum, pom, pom, each one. Just think for a moment, just think for a moment. You're in the dominant, okay?
Uh-huh.
And you're going to resolve here. Is it necessary to make the break? I don't think so. I think you're in the minimum there.
Uh-huh.
Make the crescendo to the end. Have the courage to make the crescendo to the end. And instead of going, as if you're going to mezzo forte or to forte.
Okay.
And instead of that, at the last moment, you hold back.
Okay.
Yes. Very good. Sorry. You must make it very, very clear, clear that when you play, opens up.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And you finish. Yeah. What you opened, the phrase, the flower, whatever you want, that you open, now you close.
Yeah.
And then you finish the story.
Yes.
Then you come into the. Unexpected. You expect this. That's what you expect. It is not. Don't hurry and make me really concentrate on the fact that you have suddenly gone into minor. Okay, then you get a completely different characterization of the same music here in piano and light in major. It must really have enough. Wait, don't run, don't let the music run away.
Okay.
It needs to be controlled. And then you can. Now. All these modulations, there is a lot of tension in each one of these modulations, and the harmony has a rhythmic pattern all of its own, which has nothing to do with the rhythm of the piece or the rhythm of the melody. And this you need to hear, otherwise you are missing one of the important dimension of the musical construction. In other words, here the rhythm of the harmony is it changes once. After two bars, it is slower than the melody and a lot slower than the rhythm. Now you get. The worst thing. thing you can do when something like this happens is to hurry. Oh. Because if you hurry when there is modulations going, you do not allow the audibility of the tension. Okay. Maybe you try and play now a little bit slower, a little bit under tempo, so that we can really get all the information. Now you have understood and you have made me understand clearly the wealth of the material. Now you can decide on the tempo. You see, what you did before, you decided on the tempo and then you tried to fit the music in that tempo. Wrong order. The decision on the tempo, whether it is a little more or a little less, can only be there when you have managed to make all the content audible. And then do you say, then you have to ask yourself, is this the right speed? Am I too fast and therefore I cannot make everything audible? Or am I too slow and therefore everything falls apart? But I think now that you got all that, I think you realize that you may have been a little over the top in order to make it pause. Okay? So now play at the normal tempo. This is very good. You must really make the crescendo to the end. You're going to the precipice. And just at the last moment. See, what you did now is you made the crescendo, a little bit of it too much, too soon. Then you got to the end, you rounded it up, you didn't make the crescendo, and then you waited. And this is why we get ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta.
Okay.
Yeah, and also... I would like to hear that. Down, down, low. The second syncopation is always too early. A lot of it is very good. Very important. Never play passages like this with 16 mechanically. Otherwise, you get two different dimensions. One, the expressive dimension when it's, so to speak, interesting, and the mechanical dimension. It's very important to be able to play. This is why the decision of on the tempo is so important. It has to allow you to play phrased with what we would call a musical content, even the fastest and the most motoric of passages. Okay? From there somewhere.
Thank you.
dynamic. Piano, piano. Sorry.
The
two elements which are very important, very strict with syncopations, you know, you cannot...
Yes.
There's no room for flexibility with syncopation because the syncopation depends on the fact that it doesn't come on the strong beat. What is the dynamic? What is the dynamic?
Piano.
Ah. What is the dynamic there?
It's still the same. It's pianissimo. Everything here.
So why do you play more?
Because I like it.
I'm very sorry. With all due respect, it's not good enough. Mm-hmm. If you had said to me, I play it louder, although it's not written, because there is a diminished ninth which has to be resolved, I would have said, chapeau. I may not agree, but you have thought of a good reason to say, because I like it.
No,
that's not good enough.
Of course.
It's not good enough. So let's erase that I don't like it. I like it. Let's erase that and let's start again. Why do you play louder?
Because harmonically, it's very important. This note.
Is that the first time that the E flat is there?
No, it's there before.
Right.
But we are here waiting and we think it's... But we have one last time this.
Yeah.
And I think it's important, enough important to make it louder. And for the character, I think it, for me, does make sense. I'm sorry if it does not make sense.
No. You don't have to apologize. Yeah. No. I think we are doing very well. No. Now, I'm just trying to understand. Look, I'm not trying to compare what you're trying to do with how I think it goes.
Uh-huh.
I'm trying to make sure that maybe I can help you to achieve more of what you want yourself.
Yes.
Okay? Now, that's why it's important for me to know why. Now, you have told me that you want because of the tension. I have then pointed out to you that the E-flat is already there.
Yes.
Therefore, by playing it louder, you're not making anything special out of it. I'm playing devil's advocate. You're not making anything special out of it. You are simply repeating this tense interval lower again, and we know it already. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I think that if what you want to show is that there's something special because of the weight, if you play it softer, the effect will be a lot stronger.
Uh-huh.
I agree with you that it needs something special,
yes.
That it cannot be the same. Mm-hmm. But I have to tell you that I think that the option that you took makes actually a less of a good result for what you want than playing softer.
Okay.
Can we agree on
that? Yes, totally.
See, it's already there. Take the pedal off.
It does work, yeah.
Thank you.
No.
What I'm trying to say is, it's not a question whether it works or not. Mm-hmm. Is that once you have actually established that, and you want to make something special, if you make it louder, it's not a question that it doesn't work. It destroys its own purpose.
Yeah.
What I think, however, is... Sorry, I don't remember. The change, you will get it by stopping the pedal. The pedal has been there all the time.
Uh-huh.
And suddenly there's a moment of silence.
Yeah.
And then you play even softer. And then you make the clash between so close, even though, and then half release, and then you must come out. But if you have done all these very imaginative dynamics, you must come out with a very clear, definite forte afterwards.
Okay.
That says enough of all this flirting with diminished ninths and all this thing. This is it.
Yeah.
This must be very clear. tempo, keep the tempo.
Off. And less. And go.
It will help you if you get really the same physical movement of the hands for each chord. You know, you play yum, pum, all from the same distance, or close, or far, whatever you want, but three the same. Yum, pum, that's it. Then you will be able to control that better. Okay.
A new element.
It's a completely different music in order to bring you back to the tonic, to this home key.
Yeah.
So you must make very clear you are. And you will not be able to play this light enough. Whatever you play is too much. Because it must be really the familiarity of knowing where you are and having the lightness to play around with it.
Okay.
If this would be orchestrated, I am sure it would be orchestrated with a different instrument, maybe with a flute or something light at that moment, which does not happen before. Why don't you play from the E major? That's wonderful. That's much better than the first. Bravo. It's really wonderful. Yeah. Now, David, when you get to that, you don't, you know, even that later said, now you have for the first time, you have something. This has never been before, this figure.
Yes.
You have had this rhythm, but you have never had this.
Yes.
In the dominant. It must have something special.
Yes.
Many ways of doing this special. You can make the tempo a little bit slower or a little bit faster. You know, it's a slight change if you want. This is the kind of question where a slight modification of tempo is not only permissible, but sometimes necessary. Or you can maybe change, get a new sound with more pedal. It can also be short and still bathe in pedal. If you play it very soft, you must play very soft to do that.
Okay.
I'm trying to give you the different options, you know, but not. This is too commonplace. It reminds us too much of everything that we have been hearing. You must have something new. And I'm suggesting to you the pedal, because then you get... And you get...
Yes.
You must get the shortness. So if you can find a way of enveloping this phrase with a little bit of haze of pedal, not so that one doesn't understand the texture anymore, it will give you the possibility to then get back to the dryness at the end. The diminished seventh. And now, no, really, really, the fortissimo, right hand. Bravo, bravo, very good. Huh? Bravo, it's really, really wonderful, no? I would like to say, take the opportunity to say a couple of sentences about tempo in relation to a piece that is obviously more rhythmical. What is actually tempo rubato, and what is its purpose? I mean, the word we know means stolen time. So, in a society that accepts certain morals, what you steal, at some point you have to give back. This is important to remember, because very often the rubato, especially in 19th century music, is done over too short a span of time. An ideal rubato is one in which you have the metronome going, and you are absolutely with the metronome, and when you start going rubato, let us say for four bars, for these four bars you are out of sync with the metronome, but on the fifth bar you are miraculously back again where it is. This is the ideal moral definition of tempo rubato. It's not always possible to do, but this is, I think, something worth remembering. The art of the rubato is to find not only whether to go a little bit slower or to go a little bit faster, but to know over what amount of time to do that, number one. Number two, tempo rubato means it's not completely in sync with the objective time. Yeah. Why is it that when you say to somebody, why don't you play this a little more rubato, the first thing they will do is play slower? If it's out of sync with the tempo, it should also be possible in the other direction. And the art of stealing time to go faster is in some ways more difficult than the art of stealing time by getting slower. But what is the role, and is there a role for a flexibility of tempo, even in its most imperceptible way, in a movement that is as rhythmical as this? There's obviously not a question of the possibility of rubato there. Yeah. We agree about that. Now, the end, the coda of the piece, brings, as we just heard you yourself to it, a completely new element. And obviously, if you were to take the whole coda of the movement and even slightly modify its speed, you would break the structure, you would break the unity. But if you can master the art of doing this imperceptibly and always give back where you're coming, you might get the possibility of something very imaginative and very original, which has not been there
in the movement. In other words, in the movement, and I'm not telling you this is the only way to do it. I'm only just mentioning to you a possibility of maybe one extra means of expression. You know, you have nothing, right? Now. Almost like in a question mark. Slightly under tempo, slightly under tempo. And immediately the question is, by God, the structure will go. And you have to stay then. And reality is still there. Aha. Aha. No. I use this as an example to show you that you can make slight rubato without losing the organic sense, provided you do that over a certain amount of time. Uh-huh. Now, if I would not come back, it would break the line.
Uh-huh. Yes.
It's too long.
Yes. Yes.
You know? And this is really what tempo rubato is, isn't it? You are in a situation which you find interesting or pleasurable, and 2 minutes, 2 hours seem like 2 minutes. You're in a situation which is boring or uncomfortable, and 2 minutes seem 2 hours. Mm-hmm. This is the subjective understanding, but the clock is still showing you the 2 minutes or the 2 hours. Sound, if you learn how to see all its implications, allows you not only to have a subjective feeling of slower or longer, but also of manipulating that in the best sense of the word, that if you give back and then you get a feeling of the strictness, which is paradoxically only expressed through the freedom that you have used to express it. This is in one simple word. Okay? Any questions?
I really enjoyed watching you work with him, Maestro Barenboim. And one thing you brought out very early on was the importance of using the rests and the silence to transition from one musical idea to the next. And I wonder if you could elaborate on that just a little bit more.
I'll give you a short summary, okay? Saying that sound does not really exist, as it were, by itself in this world. You know, sound is always in relation with silence. I happen to think that this is one of the first moments that we see that sound enables music to have a tragic dimension, because every note is just about to die, and you keep it. The minute you play two or three notes bound, legato, you get the tension that is created that wants to defy the will of the sound to go into silence. In other words, not unlike human life, it comes out of nowhere, develops, and ends in a similar nowhere. But I think we can all agree that this is not a piece that is of the most tragic and dramatic nature. It is a rather lightening. And yet, it is absolutely dependent on the relationship between the music and the silence. And that if the silence is not of the right duration, and the last sound before that, you heard David play, you know, when he controlled it, it was absolutely wonderful. It gave you a sense of uprightness and of something very positive. And when he tended to hurry because he was not controlling it at a certain moment, almost a feeling of seasickness, you know? Well, but I mean, this is really one of the most important aspects of the permanent relationship between sound and silence. And then when you get a big climax like you get in orchestral music, a big Bruckner symphony with a chord that ends in the Bruckner ninth, there's a wonderful chord towards the end of the last movement where it is such a dissonance, you have a feeling that Bruckner found for that chord an extra three
tones. It's not 12 tone, but 15 tone, if you could. You feel this feeling of tension in it. And then if you can get the whole orchestra to sustain that to the end and stop it abruptly, yet with resonance, paradoxical or it may seem, you have the feeling, at least I do, that the silence is even louder than the cacophony of the chord. So silence can be softer, louder than the music, can serve as an element of continuity, and can serve as an element of breaking down the rhythmical pattern. Thank you.
Bravo.
If you really see your life in music as such, you will have a constant interest. Boredom will never come into it. Can't. Boredom comes only with repetition. And the most important thing about music is its unrepeatability. It's the oneness, if one could say that. The fact that it is never the same. And every time there's a new element, something that you didn't notice, no matter that you know it by heart, no matter that my fingers have been playing the same notes since I was 8 years old. I'm now 62, so you figure it out. For 54 years I've played some of the same notes. The fingers know it, the brain knows it, and yet I find something new in it. Thank you.
really. But I would say it's the greatest.
That is great.
Brilliant.
That's brilliant.
Made in.